I rest my case.
Honourable Shane Jones.
Tēnā tātou katoa I roto I tēnei pito te tau hau. Greetings, Mr Speaker, fellow members of the House at this day in the new year. If there is ever evidence as to how poorly the Cabinet restructuring has gone, that last speech demonstrated it. Not only did he misrepresent that damp squib of a Cabinet reshuffle as decisive, it was actually divisive. What on earth possesses them to think that the promotion of Nikki Kaye is going to, number one, generate more jobs, number two, transform the economy, or in any mild way improve the prospects, sir, of 33% of New Zealand's economy and population, which is Auckland? That will only happen when there's a change of government and the member to my left enjoys the privilege of holding at long last the seat that should always have been the centre progressive left. So, sir, now you can carry on. You can carry on with all these tired barbs, but there's one thing that you'll know about this speaker, a hide thicker than a rhinoceros, sir. Let's come back to what was actually said in the Prime Minister's speech. Number one, he resents the presence of David Shearer and Ned King moving forward on housing policy. Now, what they've overlooked is that the Resource Management Act reforms that the Prime Minister, the current Minister of Environment, say they're going to deliver on, they've had phase one, they've had phase two, they've done none of it. The only thing that's happened that might remotely improve the prospects of better housing processes and prices was what was started under our administration, sir, and wisely continued by that person known as Mr Williamson, who has defeated all the pollsters and pundits' view as to who has outlived their usefulness in Cabinet. But that's another matter. That's for that side of the House to work out. So before I go and talk about houses and affordability, let's talk about a House divided within itself, the Māori Party. So the Māori Party actually requires the ongoing sustenance of the John Key government because they have no place, they have no future and no relevance in terms of how we are viewing the development of the country. One of the leaders has wisely, sir, announced that her time has come and her time has gone. She unfortunately did not check with the co-leader as to why he was hanging around. I suspect it's to do with financial circumstances or some more personal matter like that. But, sir, irrespective of who stands to lead that party is dog tucker. Now, sir, when the members of the party are openly calling for the return of Hone Harawira to lead the party, you know then it's a version of the spaceship of Doctor Who. They'll fit themselves, sir, they'll fit their members inside the proverbial telephone box. And I think it's very sad, sir, that their legacy will be to have propped up a government led by John Key, essentially driven by Stephen Joyce, and starved by Bill English, which has left the garden variety day-to-day lives of Māori households far worse off. Now, that's one fact you can't escape from. Sure, you can rely on the cultural narrative, and you can get warm and fuzzy about Matatini and we do support, in a rare outburst, sir, of bipartisan support, the ongoing work of the Minister of Treaty Settlements. But, sir, those only touch a narrow part of the broader problem. And the fact that there was so much aspiration, so much goal, so much dream associated with the Māori Party, and it is now evident, not only is the vessel empty, the vessel is sinking. But, sir, help's on the way. Those members who were there are privately telling us they cannot wait, and indeed one of the orators at Ratna Pass said he cannot wait for the prospect for David Shearer and fellow Labor members with associated parties to form a progressive government. And what are they going to do? The reason they're going to move on housing, not the reason they're going to move, because it's the hallmark of a progressive government. It's not unreasonable that the state play a more active role in providing assistance for people to own the largest asset the vast majority of Kiwis have the pleasure of owning, their own whare. Why is it good enough for the farmers to receive a subsidy in irrigation, but no assistance be extended to low to middle income New Zealanders to get the only asset they're likely to truly own. Why is it good enough for $600 million to be doled out to the farming community, yet they are remaining flinty and mean-spirited without providing any such assistance to those Kiwis who want to actually acquire? Now, let me ask a question, sir. Will that water be free? Will that water be conceived as a public good? Will that water attract a tax? Will the farmers ever pay any of the dough back that's going to be poured down the gullet of this new subsidy trail called publicly subsidised irrigation schemes? All those results, all those answers, all those facts currently elude us. But don't for a moment think that we'll allow that policy to go forward whilst the blowtorch is going to be placed upon Mr Shearer and Annette King about our housing policy. So housing solutions have to be varied. There is no such thing as a universal, singular housing accommodation solution. So in some cases, sir, it will suit small families, large families, blended families. And sir, the main thing that the speech today from our side of the House has emphasised is the political will to use the resources of the state to enable New Zealanders to move out of homelessness, not owning their own property, and escaping from a permanent situation of being a stuck member of the rentier class. So that is a worthwhile idea. That is a notion that's perfectly legitimate to contest as politicians. Now, what's been the response? What will be the response of the government? Well, they'll look for a chorus of people to diminish the merits of the scheme. But, sir, the merits have already taken root within the minds of the people that are going to benefit from the scheme. That's why polling shows it's a brilliant policy. That's why, sir, a host of experts in the area of social development, property development, saying this is the kind of lever that can significantly turn around large swathes of the economy. Now, sir, I'm prepared to admit that there is some merit associated with increasing apprenticeships. It's a pity that it's taken 4 years too late, and it was nicked, sir, off this side of the House after that side of the House destroyed apprenticeships, ruined trade training, and tried to turn young New Zealanders into workers of a precarious nature. So we are not going to acquiesce or agree with that. Now, at the time, I'm presuming, sir, that the earlier National government decided to destroy apprenticeships so they could depress the value of wages. Well, sir, not only did they destroy the value of wages, they destroyed the value of being an artisan, of being a craftsman, of being a tradesman, of being an expert with vocational qualifications. And in a funny way, sir, they arrived at a point where their ideologists wanted them to be. Change some of the foundation influences of what a Kiwi's proud to be. So thousands of our households come from families, not the small, narrow, privileged farmer class that's going to get $600 million of free money for water that they'll never pay for. But rest assured, sir, once we bring in our capital gains tax, that show will be over. Those people who have farmed purely for capital gain, that show is ta-ta. Good night, Irene. So that, sir, pleasure awaits us once the voters give us the privilege of governing again. But, sir, I digress. That belongs at another time. Sir, one thing I will wind up on. Whilst it's a good opportunity for us to exchange ideas and exchange views, it's sad that the government does not appear interested or capable of changing tack. Just to remind ourselves, this is a government that believes that we can improve the fortunes of New Zealanders by selling assets we already own. Now, if we just look at the sell-off of the Fonterra shares, it gives you an indication of who will end up owning the shares of our energy companies. 40% foreign-owned. How on earth does that transform the fortunes of ordinary households in New Zealand? Secondly, sir, on the question of Fonterra, I suspect, as we drill into the minister responsible for primary produce, We're going to learn how implicated and how acquiescent was the government in actually covering up information associated with the recent Fonterra scandal, but that's another matter. So, sir, a group of parliamentarians back, happy to do the best for their country, heard a speech from the Prime Minister which just fills us with dread because it's the same dismal, tired, irrelevant and very, sir, thoughtless rhetoric. Kia ora tātou.
Honourable Maurice Williamson.
Mr Speaker, I'm delighted.